Was that who?
I was like, no.
What's that?
I said, why did he call it torn in, like, why did he call it torn?
Torn.
Hey, Don.
When you pick up your vehicle, it's a great deal.
Oh.
Why did he call it torn? I'm gonna call it.
I don't think, mine don't say torn, mine says, towing and roadside. Roadside service.
Don, you might wanna look through the camera, the past guesstimate, and make sure it's not cutting his head in half.
Okay, you guys ready? Ready?
Is it on?
Should be. Cindy, would you pray for us today, please?
Most gracious Heavenly Father, thank you for this opportunity to come together, Father. Father, I just ask you, let the word speak to each of our hearts, Father. Let us open our hearts to receive the word. Father, I thank you, I love you, and I praise your name. In Christ's very precious name, I pray. Amen.
Amen. Like I've said today, nobody would take the word and do something with it, so Jesus came and did it himself. Because God doesn't want to let his word fail, right? How many believe the word of God will give you salvation? Amen. Well, it'll also give you a rest. And that rest is not just a Sunday off. It's something far greater than that. That's what we've been talking about, the Lord's Day versus the Sabbath. Now, the Sabbath seems like something that's no good, it's past, and yet Sunday, we're going to learn, is really a picture of the Sabbath too. It's the day of the sun will one day become the day of God, okay? And it will be a day of rest. That's what you need to see. But anyway, without getting into that too greatly, the Bible says that if you even started a fire in your tent or whatever in the wilderness under the Ten Commandments, that remember the old man that started a fire to keep his granny warm? God said, okay, Moses, kill him. That was a pretty sad thing, but that's the way it was. And yet when Jesus came, he worked on the Sabbath, didn't he? Just a quick review. Does anybody wonder, who does he think he is working on the Sabbath?
He's God.
Now, he's owner of that Sabbath, right? We learned that. So the messianic behavior that he was doing was kind of trying to let people know that time had come for him for things to change. Time had come for things to change. Now, Jesus asked an important question before he began to, as he was being questioned and tried and checked out as the lamb. He was that good lamb, wasn't he? But he asked a question. He says, was the baptism of John of God or of man? Who was the first person that, who was the greatest person that John the Baptist ever baptized?
Jesus Christ.
Amen. And he obeyed that baptism of John. That kind of tells you that it was of God, isn't it? You never see where Jesus went and told any of the Pharisees and Sadducees or any of these people where he went up and asked him to do anything for him, did he? But he told John, suffer it to be so now. The same token is true right now. Okay? We need to be obedient. And baptism has its place, but the baptism is only a beginning, just like it was a beginning of Jesus' ministry. It's also a beginning of ours, okay? So, number one, we said the work that Jesus did on the Sabbath was a messianic behavior, and Matthew 12:8 says he's the Son of Man is the Lord of the Sabbath. I'm just reviewing real quick. And then Matthew 2:28 says the same thing. He's the Lord of the Sabbath. And he purposefully worked on the Sabbath and picked projects that he could do and he made sure he did them on the Sabbath. And he was trying to teach everybody, prove to everybody something wasn't. Just like God when he was doing the 10 plagues in Egypt, he was trying to prove to Israel. No, he was proving to Egypt too that he was the only God there was. Amen? All righty. So Egypt worshiped all kind of gods. And I think today in America, we're trying to go and become like Egypt. We want to worship everything. We say, oh yeah, Jesus Christ is real, but if it's cool, you worship Allah and anybody else too if you want to. We're trying to do the same thing, right? So why do we keep the Lord's Day if they kept the Sabbath day in the old times? Why do we do that, okay? The Sabbath day of the Old Testament was really just a shadow of the things of the new, okay? okay? I'm on page 3 in mine, but it's a fine print, okay? I'm under a big B. So why don't we keep the Lord's Day if they kept the Sabbath on the day? Aren't we kind of repeating the same thing? A lot of people, I guarantee today, are keeping Sunday for that same reason. They have no idea what they're doing. They just come to church on Sunday because that's what Grandpa did, okay? That is not why you come to church. You come to church for a reason, amen? Just like the Jewish people kept the Sabbath. What do you think that reason was? Why keep the Sabbath? Why keep Sunday? What do you think the reason is, in your own words? Don't worry about being right or wrong here. Just why do you think it was?
To stop worrying about the worldly effects, fleshly needs, wants, desires, and do something that was for God.
Okay.
People get so wrapped up in everyday life.
Okay, good. But there's something I'm looking for, I guess, a little more finite than that. It represents a day, doesn't it? What kind of day do you think it represents? It represents a day when the Lord is going to come. And the Lord, or come again. Or the Lord, there is a day coming when the Lord's coming here. We're not, we think we're going to Him? No, we're not. It's always been. We come to the Lord, or God comes to us first, doesn't He? Just like He loves us first. Okay, so under point number 3 there, let's look at that. It says, why do we keep the Lord's Day if they kept the Sabbath day in the Old Testament? Well, the Sabbath started on a Friday evening at 6 p.m. and it would end Saturday evening at 6 p.m. See, and everything's beginning at evening and going to the morning, right? For a day. But you see, it's a 24-hour cycle there. Well, the Lord's Day is a Sunday. It kind of works similar in the same thing. It works from a time of night to day. Yeah. All right. In AD 313, Constantius gave permission to the Christians to keep the Lord's Day. That's something they wanted to do. They wanted to set up a day where they could remember and keep the Lord's word, worship what Jesus had done. Okay? So why not just keep the Sabbath day? Why change it? Why do you think they needed to change it? Why change it? If they all had the same purpose and meaning, why change that day?
Well, the Sabbath day was supposed to be a day of rest. God created the earth.
Yeah, well, the Israelites were resting on that day. The only people who weren't supposed to rest was preachers. So, that day represents a man, too, doesn't it? Right? Who's a picture of the Sabbath in the Old Testament? Moses is. Who's a picture of the Sabbath or the Lord's Day in the New Testament? Jesus Christ is. Well, what day are we waiting on now? The Father's Day, okay? The Lord, the King's Day, you might say. Okay, a day when the sun will never need to be shining again because he is our Son. Revelation tells us that. Okay. Since the Master and owner of the Sabbath came, we need to hold on to Him, the real thing, rather than the day. In the Old Testament, they were keeping a day, and they didn't. When the Master come, He was that day, wasn't He? Do you want to hold on to a day, or do you want to hold on to the guy? You want to hold on to the guy. Well, if the Lord came and we were here this Sunday, and the Lord was down there in the Live Oak Church, what should we hold on to? Sunday worship at Covenant Church, or should we go over there where the Lord is? I'm not telling you to go to Live Oak Church, don't get me wrong. That's not what I'm going to say. Okay. God abolished the Sabbath day in Hosea chapter 2, verse 11. There's no place in the New Testament that says for the Son of Man to keep the Sabbath day. Okay? Rather, we're told to keep the Word and to keep Christ. In other words, we're to keep Him, not the day. Right? How do we become? Can we become a day? We call children of light. Well, what does that mean? If you're a child of light, that means you're a child of the day. But every day always starts out what? In darkness. Right? How do we become a child of light? If you've got darkness in you, or can you say you're a child of light, really? You may have begun, but you're not a child of light because you still got darkness in you. Okay? When you read Revelation 22 from now on, it says you'll no longer need the sun, moon, and stars. You need to think about that. It means it'll always be day. It means you'll always believe. You really will be a child of light. Okay. Rather, we're told to keep the word in Christ. Let's look at Colossians 2, 16 and 17 there. Can we read that, please? Therefore, let no one act as your judge in regard to food or to drink or in respect to a festival or to a new moon or to a Sabbath, things which are what? A mere shadow of what is to come. But the substance of the thing belongs to Christ. In other words, the day is Christ. Let's go to the next page. Okay, Galatians 4, 9 through 11, let's read that together. I'm not insulting you, you're all great readers, but we're just want to assert this stuff, right? Galatians 4, 9 through 11, let's read it. But not that you have become to know God, or rather to be known by God, how is it that you turn back to the weak and worthless elemental things to which you desire to be enslaved all over again? You observe days and months and seasons and years. I fear you, for you, that I have labored over you in vain. This is Paul talking. Now, Jesus told them he had come to set them free. What do you think he came to set them free? They were slaves to what? To the law. To the law. Aren't you glad you don't have to worry about keeping the law? In Christ. Yeah. If you fail in something, you got somebody to mediate for you. Keeping the Sabbath day is doing what? Keeping the Sabbath day is returning to the elemental things, or elementary things, right? Hebrews chapter 6 talks about that too, doesn't it? Hebrews 6 verses 2 through 8 talks about, if you go back to baptisms and this and arguments about elemental things, you know what's happening? You're crucifying Jesus all over again. Why did they crucify Jesus Christ? Because they only had elemental understanding of the Word of God and the Sabbath. They blamed Jesus for breaking the Sabbath. So, okay. Now, let's look at B there. We say, why Sunday? The first day, second day, third, fourth, fifth, sixth. The seventh day, we see here the fall of man. Then we see the eighth. Then we see the resurrection. What happened in the resurrection? God was destroying sin and death, right? That's why he was crucified on a Friday, okay? Friday would have been the sixth day, okay? Now, when Jesus destroyed sin and death, the Sabbath of the Father was symbolically recovered, okay? Symbolically recovered. Now, Jesus recovered it, but what do we have to do? We have to recover it too, don't we? Amen? So, therefore, there's a new Sabbath that God gave us. And what Sabbath is that? It's what we call the Lord's Day. We rest on Sunday. Is it possible we could wind up doing the same thing the Jews did with that day, though? If you're not careful, you'll get in a church where they'll make you do that. You ever heard of the Church of the Latter-day Saints? Stuff like that? Okay. All right. What are we talking about? Matthew 28, verse 1. Let's read that. Brother Jay?
Now after the Sabbath, as it was beginning to dawn toward the first day of the week, Mary Magdalene and the other Mary came to look at the grave.
Okay, so it was, what was it doing? It was after the Sabbath, and it was dawning towards the first day of the week. That tells us that something had happened there. What do you think had happened? It's setting the stage to discover there was the resurrection had taken place, hadn't it? Let's look at Acts 20, verse 7. Let's all read it together. Begin. And on the first day of the week, when we were gathered together in the break bread, Paul began talking to them, intending to depart the next day, and he prolonged his message until midnight. Okay? So he was, in a sense, doing this all for the same period. He was trying to keep that day, wasn't he? Okay? It was an official worship service. And what were they doing during that worship service? Breaking bread. Now, we're supposed to come to worship service not to break biscuits or bread. We're supposed to come and break the Word of God. Amen? So the Sabbath day is a shadow of the first coming of Jesus Christ. Does everybody see that? Because he came, right? Now, what do you think the Lord day is a shadow of? It's a shadow of what? The second coming. The second coming. Now, if Israel made that mistake the first time, and the Lord came, and they were keeping the day and not him, Is it possible the church could do that in the Second Amendment? You better believe it is. That's just why some people say, oh, well, we can't make that mandate because it says, the Bible says he's coming on the cloud and every eye shall see him. That's what you believe too, ain't it, Brother Russ?
Yeah.
You need to study the clouds. The Second Coming, then you'll understand what I'm talking about. You need to really study the clouds. Because the clouds he's coming on is totally different than what, you understand, the Word of God is written like a puzzle, okay? You know what a cloud is, brother? You know, what is a cloud?
A cloud is made up of gas.
Oh, you're talking about that cloud. What about God's clouds?
Prophets. Prophets and the people.
God's word is rain, right? If you have word in you, Brother Russ, you can become a cloud. I'll only get off into that. We'll teach that when I come to the clouds, okay? But you'll understand. Because Revelation 10 says there's an angel that comes, and he's got this wonderful looking face and his cool looking legs and everything. Walk around like, I mean, even Superman didn't look that good. But it says he's robed in a cloud. Robed in a cloud. Okay? Clouds, this thing is magnificently important here, okay? The Sabbath day is a shadow of the first coming, the Lord's day is a shadow of the second. Therefore, it's very important for us to keep the Lord's day. Everybody would understand that, right? Now, we need to, what do we need to want to do on the Lord's day? Did the Jewish people like keeping the Sabbath? They didn't want to keep it, did they? They disdained the Sabbath. Oh, when the Sabbath be over, we can go back and sell the short bundle and make money. It's like taking a picture of grace for the week that's coming. I thought that was a pretty good analogy. Like taking a picture of grace. Taking a picture of grace. We all want that grace, but the greatest grace you can have is God with you. Can you imagine, Brother Russ, how wonderful it would have been just to have been able to put your hands on Jesus Christ? That would have just been the awesome, ultimate experience. Amen? Okay? How come Israel couldn't do that?
Because they were embracing a day instead of a God.
Yeah, they were embracing a religious worship rather than God.
Now, we embrace the Sabbath. The Sabbath is every day. It doesn't mean we can't go to work. We should go to work with the attitude of someone that's embraced the Sabbath.
Mm-hmm. Let's look at Hebrews chapter 4, verse 8 here. There says there's a Sabbath that remains. Okay? And you could say he's already come, but we haven't entered that Sabbath yet. Okay? Don't let that happen in the second coming. If he's already come and you don't even know it, you've got a problem, haven't you? Is that possible that can happen? You better believe it is. Hebrews 4, verse 8. Let's read that together. Jesus. For if Joshua had given them rest, he would not have spoken of another day after that. Okay? Now, what did Jesus preach? Come unto me and I shall give you a hard time?
Rest.
Okay? Now, where's everybody's rest at? When Joshua was leading the Israelites, they thought they could rest as soon as they went into Canaan land. You see that? That's what you think too. However, there were things to do even when they got to Canaan. Victories to be won, battles to be fought. The whole Bible is all about fighting the good fight. In the Old Testament, the word for Hebrew and for Jesus was Joshua, Yeshua, okay? Jesus is Greek, Yeshua, okay? The root word is the same. So it's more like a word play. One is a shadow of the other, okay? Even Joshua was a shadow of Jesus Christ. Who come first, Moses or Jesus? Who come first, Moses or Joshua? So you see the same picture there, don't you? Canaan land is all a picture about going to heaven, entering the Sabbath. I'm on the next page. If you met Jesus, there must be rest. But why is there still difficulty? Why have we not entered his rest now? Well, Jesus did not give that rest yet. You understand that? He had not given it. Okay? So that means there's still a Sabbath that remains. Now, how do we get into that remaining Sabbath? Let's read Hebrews 4:7. Has everybody got that? Okay. Hebrews 4:7. He again fixes a certain day, calling it today, saying, through David, after so long a time, just as has been said before, today, if you hear his voice, do not harden your hearts. Okay, now look here. Let me play on a word here. I can call Donna today, okay? Or I say, today, hear his voice. Or I can say, today, hear his voice. And you'll say, oh, he's talking about this Sunday, hear his voice. No, I'm talking about the believer. Today is someone who has become a day. Amen? When you really believe in Christ, all that darkness stuff won't be a problem for you anymore. Okay. So the next day, let's look at that. The day of the Son of Man is also called today. It is not a 24-hour period. It's called the day of the Lord. Hey, Brother Jay, when the Lord comes, it ain't going to get dark anymore, brother. Amen? So when does that day end? It never ends, amen? Okay, spiritually and literally, okay? It's when the day or the light and darkness meet that a man becomes a day, okay? Now, there wasn't any darkness in Jesus, but where was the darkness that Jesus met? This world. He come to change this world into a world of light. Can God do that? Did Jesus fail in doing that? Cindy looks like wants to say something.
No, I just want to say, Jesus didn't fail, but man fell.
We failed God, didn't we? Isn't that what the fall is all about? Don't we fall short of the hope and the glory of God? How many of you think you're falling short anymore? Until you become a burnt offering, you're falling short. Amen? Okay, so the light was Jesus Christ. It's the Word. He's called the morning. Okay? The darkness was Israel. It was called night. Okay? So when the people of Israel receive Jesus Christ, it becomes a day. When you receive Jesus, what does it mean you're supposed to also be receiving? The Word. Have you ever met people that said, I love Jesus, but I don't like studying my Bible? What's the problem? You met the man, but you hadn't met the Word. You hadn't met God yet. Amen? You got to meet the Word. That's what you got to meet. You're not going to know Jesus if you don't meet the Word. Okay. Let's read John chapter 1, verse 5. It's right there under that. Let's read that. And the light shines in the darkness, and the darkness did not comprehend it. Isn't that amazing? See? The darkness did not comprehend it. Everybody in Israel was darkness, brothers. You know what they also are? They're also called the seas. And when God shines his sun on the sea, what happens to the water, Brother Steve? They change, don't they? They transform, don't they? And what happens to them, Brother Russ? They become this gaseous form, and they ascend, and they get up in the cloud, they get up in the sky. They kind of hang out in the clouds, hang up there with them other clouds for a while, and next thing you know, another cloud bumps into them. It's got a little bit of rain in it. Next thing you know, they got some rain. Amen? That's what I pray y'all would do. Hang out in the church long enough with other clouds till some of the other clouds got some rain in them will get in you. Hallelujah! Amen. That's what needs to happen. Russell said, he's crazy. No, I'm not crazy. You need to study the Word of God. That's what it is. Okay. I'm not offending you. I'm just trying to teach you. Okay. So, let's look at Luke 17, 20 through 21. Let's read that together with one voice. Begin. Now, having been questioned by the Pharisees as to when the kingdom of God was coming, he answered and said to them, the kingdom of God is not coming with signs to be observed, like a day, nor will they say, look, here it is, or there it is. For the kingdom of God is in your midst. What is he saying? He said, hello, I'm right here, and you don't even see me. You don't comprehend me. The king is here. Did you know there was only one time when Jesus came into Jerusalem as the king? Now, he was the king all the time. But he only came into Israel, into Jerusalem, the city. He came there to die. But they called him again. Remember what I said today? Wouldn't it have been great if it all went out to him? See, the Pharisees said, I told you, son of a gust, to get out there and stop them from coming to that man called Jesus. Now look what's happening. Everybody's believing in him. The world's going on. I wish the whole world would go out there. Okay, let's look at that point. The kingdom of God is in your midst. That means Jesus was like a shepherd and a pastor. He was with them and he was among them. This is why we have church pastors today. We are with you and we are shepherding the flock. You're the flock and I'm the shepherd. But you know what? When we meet Jesus, you know what I become? I become a flock too. Amen. All right. In the first coming, let's see what happens here, okay? In the first coming, point A there, when the light swallowed the darkness, it became the eternal day, or today's, okay? Since Israel did not understand that light, though, he said they could not see that day. Do you understand what I just said? That is so pregnant. He was the day. He was God. He was the Word. But they couldn't see either one of those things. But he was already amongst them. Now, what does Revelation 22 tell us? He will be amongst us. Where was he at in the Garden of Eden? In the last days, you got to go back to the mountain of God. The mountain of God is what? It's Eden. It's paradise. You got to go back there. That's where I believe that's the departure place. Okay? That's where real change is going to take place. You know what, though, guys? You got to be able to see it. Not with these eyes, but with the eyes of the Spirit. It's by the Spirit you cry, Abba, Father. I can't tell Russ, here he is, there he is. Can I? That's against the Word of God. But what if the Spirit of God and the Word tells Russ, there he is? That'd be a different thing, wouldn't it? Amen? That's what Jesus was trying to say. See, people today say, if somebody tells you he's out there, don't believe him. That's what they were talking about, John the Baptist and stuff like that. But how would they have known that Jesus Christ was God? How do y'all think? Somebody in here just tell me, how could they have known him? If they'd have known the Word, they would have known him. Why? Because he was the Word. And who was the Word? The Word was Jesus Christ. And he was in the beginning. And he said, I was before Abraham. Before Abraham was, I was. Before Abraham was, I am. He was the I am of Moses. So crazy, isn't it, church? Okay? So, B. Let's look at point B here. It's the day when a certain day becomes today. See, Jesus needed to become their day. Now, what does it mean to become their day? You need to go read Revelation. He needs to become your God and your light. And if he feels... How many of you understand if I turned off all the lights in here and it was midnight, it'd probably get dark? Well, how about if I just light up a candle in here? See how powerful light is? Changes everything. What about if I turn all these new lights on? Changes everything. You can see your Bibles now. Amen? What about if Jesus Christ came into this room? Huh? That'd be even fantastic, wouldn't it? That'd be better than any light bulb you could buy. I guarantee you that. Okay. It's the day when a certain day becomes a day, Hebrews 4:7. I pray that certain day will become your day too, okay? His voice. What is his voice? So today, if you hear his voice. Cindy, what is his voice? Hebrews 4:7 says, today, if you hear his voice. Now, how do you become that today that hears the voice? How do you hear his voice? It says today, if you hear his voice, a certain day. If you hear his voice, that voice becomes what? The transformation. It becomes the real Sabbath. Not just a day that you come to church. Not just a day that somebody comes to church and says, oh, well, nothing happened today. Hey, what happened to church today? Oh, nothing. Same as last Sunday. We need to be a church where something's happening. Amen?
Amen.
Okay. If we only receive this word, then we too can become a today and we will change. That's what the transfiguration is all about. If you ain't changing now, you're not going to change then either. Okay? You're not going to know him, that's why, until it's too late. All eyes are going to see him, but that's too late. When your natural eye sees the Lord, it's too late. Too late. Hebrews 4:12. Let's read that. Hebrews 4:12. Isn't God active and alive, powerful? Well, let's read Hebrews 4:12. Jeez, huh? For the word of God is living and active and sharper than any two-edged sword, and piercing as far as the division of the soul and the spirit, of both joints and marrow, able to judge the thoughts and intentions of the heart. Boy, that Jesus could do all that stuff. Okay? Now, we're headed where you wanted to go, the last page. Right? Why does God suddenly move the writer to speak now about the Word of God? He suddenly starts talking about the Word. Why did God have the writer of Hebrews to start talking that way? Because the Sabbath can only come to us through the Word of God. You understand that? The Sabbath can only come to you through the Word of God. 1 Peter 3:14, let's read that. Begin. But even if you should suffer for the sake of righteousness, you are blessed. And do not fear them, their intimidation, and do not be troubled. See, if you have the Word and you believe in God, you wouldn't, nothing can trouble you. Nothing can intimidate you. That's you're at rest with God already. Nothing can shake you. Let's look at the next sentence here. When Jesus said to the thief on the right side, "Today you will be with me in paradise," what does he mean? You can go to paradise because you became a today. That's pretty cool, isn't it, Don? You can go to paradise because you have become a today. Jesus didn't literally go to paradise. He went to the grave. Let's look at Luke 23:41-43. Are you ready? Everybody want to read that? This is like the NASCAR. It's the last race, last lap.
Okay? And we indeed justly, for we are receiving what we deserve for our deeds. But this man has done nothing wrong. And he was saying, "Jesus, remember me. Remember, be when you came in your..."
You come in your kingdom.
Oh, so they put "be" here instead of "me." "Remember me when you come into your kingdom." And he said to him, "Truly, I say to you, today you shall be with me in paradise."
Mm-hmm. So you see that? He's saying today you and me both going to be in paradise? That's what it seems like he's saying, isn't it?
Everyone takes that as a time reference.
Yeah, as a time reference. And it is not. It is not a time reference. He's saying today, he said, you've become a child of light. Why? Because even on a cross, he confessed that Jesus Christ was God. Does everybody understand that?
Amen.
You can become a child of God by confessing Jesus as Lord.
Paradise isn't necessarily a place, it's a knowledge. It's a knowledge of who Christ is and accepting it.
It's a relationship. That's right. Knowledge commits. Knowledge begets. See, the knowledge comes from what? The Word of God. And the Word of God is what gives you your new birth. Hallelujah. So you're right. You need a new birth, a new relationship. So Jesus was the Father, church. And he was saying, I am the Father, and I came to change you. That's in putting it in everyday terms. He said, I am the Father, and I have come to change you. You know why he had to come to do it himself? Because nobody else would do it. Amen? Now, let me ask you something. This is not being mean. I'm just being serious. Who's going to bring your loved ones to church? You want me to go do it? Don't wait for God to have to divinely come down out of heaven to come get your children or your family or your loved ones or your friends or your cohorts. You go get them. Put some feet on your prayers. Amen? But you need to become a light, a child of light first. Be sure you believe before you start trying to cast demons out. If you don't, the demons will beat you up. Okay. In the last days, he will give us this word, and that word will make us change and transform first. Then he himself will transform after that. And I believe that is how we attain our righteousness, okay? Jesus changed in their midst, didn't he? How about on the Mount of Transfiguration? He had taught the word. You know, you think about it. Moses, did Moses go to heaven, church? Did Moses go to Canaan? Yeah, he did. Yes, he did. He surely went to Canaan. What did we say Canaan was? He said it just a few minutes ago. Not a literal place. When do you see Moses in Canaan? You see him on the Mount of God. What is the Mount of Transfiguration? Any mountain where God reveals himself becomes the mountain of God. Amen? No. Jesus was the mountain, church. He's the rock that becomes a great and mighty mountain. Amen? But who was on that mountain with him? Who did Peter, James, and John see up there?
Moses, Elijah, Jesus.
Kamsa Hamnida. He saw Moses on that mountain. And Moses was in a glorified body. Amen? So wonderfully so, that's called the Mount of Transfiguration. I'm telling you, Eden is a place where we too will change. The problem is Peter, James, and John went up there and they saw it, and they come back and said, duh, I thought Elijah had to come first. Hey, you dummy, you just saw him. Hey, you dummy, John was doing the work of Elijah. Amen? What work are you guys doing? What work are you doing? Well, I come to church on Sunday. I love you for that. God gotta have people in to make a church. But what are you doing for the Lord? I pray you will learn what it really means to let your life become a burnt offering for God. You know what that means? When you become a burnt offering, like I said last week, all the offerings, Brother Jay, the sin offering, all the living sacrifice, all those offerings, we could always eat some of it. But whether it be a dove, a pigeon, a bull, a lamb, whatever it was, as a burnt offering, you know what part of that you got? Nothing. Absolutely nothing. And we sing that song all the time. I wish you could just sing it right now. Make my life a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to you. Oh, we say that so good. Mariah Carey could do a good job of that. And we'd love it. But I wonder if God would want to hear Mariah sing it or you. I think he wants to hear you sing it, don't you? Let's pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Thank you, church. You're beautiful. You're wonderful. And if you don't think you're beautiful enough, look back in the mirror again. If you're looking in that mirror, you're looking in the wrong one. I'm talking about the